complications with percutaneous biliary drainage, the expected and the unexpected. So the case involves a 71-year-old gentleman who was ECOG 1, known case of diabetes and hypertension, presented with complaints of jaundice and loss of appetite since 1 month. On examination, the GC was good, the patient was deeply ectoric, and per abdomen was soft. These were the baseline investigations. We can see that the bilirubin levels were significantly elevated and the counts were slightly raised. MRCP was done, which was suggestive of a hilar cholangio-CA, bismuth classification type 3A block with few enlarged periportal lymph nodes. The joint clinic plan was to do a PTBD and a brush cytology. So PTBD was done, which confirmed type 3A block, and brush cytology was also performed with the brush, Cytomax brush. The report of brush cytology came as adeno-CA cells. The patient was being planned for stenting, however, had abdominal distension 2 days following the procedure. He was vitally stable but irritable on examination. An ultrasound abdomen revealed free fluid with echoes within. Aspiration was done, which revealed hemorrhagic fluid, following which a pictil was inserted. Simultaneous hemoglobin was repeated, which came to be 6.9. The hemoglobin at admission was 14.6. So this was a significant drop. The patient was shifted to ICU. Blood was arranged and a transfusion was started. Taken up for angioembolization. The RHA was replaced, whereas the left hepatic artery angiogram revealed active extravasation of contrast. So this is the selective microcatheter injection of left hepatic artery. Then glue embolization was done, and this is the post-embolization angiogram. Following embolization, the patient started improving. The patient was kept in ICU only. In the meantime, the bile culture sensitivity report came, which showed growth of E. coli, Klebsiella, and Enterococcus with pseudo hyphae. Patient was already on cefoperazone sulbactam combination. To this, meropenem and fluconazole were added. Once the infection was settled, a bilateral metal biliary stenting was done, and the IV antibiotics were continued. The patient was improving clinically until 3 days after stenting, he developed sudden pain abdomen in the night. This was followed by rapid deterioration of the clinical condition. The patient was becoming severely dyspneic, and the BP also started dropping. So an emergency contrast CT was done, which revealed a significant pneumoperitoneum with some air-containing collection near the biliary stents. The patient was immediately taken up for an exploratory laparotomy, and intraoperatively there was biliary peritonitis with organized clot around the biliary duct. The left bile duct was eroded with the stent exposed. Here is a intraoperative image. The arrow points at the exposed metallic framework of the stent, which can be seen intraoperatively. A warm saline washer was given, and since a reconstruction was not feasible due to the metal stents, an omental patch was placed by the operating surgeons, and drains were placed in the subhepatic pelvic regions along with the JP drain around the left bile duct. So following this, the patient was shifted to ICU, extubated on post-operative day one, and kept on inotropic and HNFC supports. The inotropic supports started tapering, antibiotics were stepped up, ticoplanin was also added. Then PTBD was done. Since the drain output was not reducing from the JP drain placed around the left hepatic duct, a re-PTBD was done. And after doing bilateral PTBD, this was the cholangiogram, which revealed active extravasation of contrast surrounding the biliary stents. Since with external drain also, the drain output did not come out with biliary diversion, a decision to place bilateral stent grafts as a bailout maneuver was taken. And this is the placement of the two biliary stents. Covered fluency stent grafts were placed bilaterally. And following bilateral stent graft placement, this was the final cholangiogram, which is performed from both the sheets simultaneously. So we can see that there is no active extravasation right now, which was seen previously. The bile leak started reducing post-procedure. The antibiotics were continued. The external biliary catheters were kept for a closure trial. The bile was allowed to drain internally, and there was no increase in the drain output after this. The left JP drain was also removed on post-operative day 11, since the output was minimal, and the patient was discharged on post-operative day 30. We faced three major complications in this case: hemorrhage and infection, which are known usually with biliary drainages. However, the bile duct rupture was not something very common which we encounter, that led to biliary peritonitis, and somehow the hemorrhage also contributed to flaring up of the infection. There were a lot of clots which were evacuated intraoperatively by the surgeons. So these are the 2020 SIR guidelines which state the incidence of such procedures and the suggested threshold. Also, a meta-analysis revealed that the bleeding complications, though, are more common after PTBD, but the rest of the complications like bile leak and sepsis are much less with PTBD compared to endoscopic drainages. Thank you.
Yeah, Arun, any comments?
So I think everything was went fine, but I am not happy with placing the covered stent in the in a hilar cholangio. That too, the stents almost covering. So basically, both these stents are ultimately the two ducts, one from the right and the rest all are obstructed. The leak, even if there was a biliary rupture, definitely possibly a long-term external drainage, and wherever it is draining, placing a drain might be a better, because ultimately patient, there are definite very high chances that you have covered the rest of the bile ducts and can cause sepsis.
Yes, sir.
So how much is the follow-up, Mohammed, you have in this case?
Following the next month, the patient was actually taken to a hospital with breathlessness, and it was presumed that he succumbed to pulmonary embolism the following month.
You see, that is what Arun was saying. Actually, we really don't know the exact cause, but covering all the ducts was, I think, could have been not a very good choice. Otherwise, case was, I mean, you have managed all the complications.
Sir, the thing was that the amount of duct eroded, which was found intraoperatively, the surgeons were of the opinion that with external drainage, even after putting an omental patch, such was the leak that they were saying it is unlikely that it will heal. Also, the albumin levels of the patient had dropped significantly. They were hovering around 2.3, 2.4. So the healing process was not very good in this patient. We had taken into account that placing a covered stent will definitely jail the other biliary ducts. But this was done mainly as a bailout procedure to the complication.
Okay. Any comments, Abhishek?
Sir, my personal view is matching with Dr. Arun sir's view, that he has put these uncovered stents, the Luminex stent, he is not supposed to put the covered. Rather than he should have opted for the internal external PTBT drainage on a first basis. Otherwise, in the due course of time, say for in a week or so, patient may land up into further sepsis because of subsegmental blockage.
Yes. Okay.
All the part was well managed as according to the guidelines.
Okay. I think, Arun, we can move on to the next case. Thank you, Mohammed.
Thank you, sir.
The next presentation we have is from Dr. Akhil Munga. Dr. Akhil Munga, you can start your presentation now.
Good evening, everybody. I am Dr. Akhil Munga, and I am second year fellow at Kuwait Medical Center and Hospital. I am presenting a case regarding feeding artery rupture following balloon assisted glue embolization of a large renal angiomyolipoma.
How soon does the battery drain?
So the patient was a 30 year old female, and the symptoms were vague abdominal pain. She had been going to the general physician 2-3 times, but they could not find out any cause. And finally, a CT scan of the abdomen was ordered. The scan showed there was a large upper and midpole fat-containing lesion suggestive of an angiomyolipoma. Another small one was seen in the right kidney. And the size was around 10 to 11 centimeters. There was some amount of angiographic component that was seen. As a result, we thought whether we should go ahead and treat this patient or not. And the treatment criteria for these conditions include active life-threatening hemorrhage, and non-life-threatening signs and symptoms, including pain and recurrent gross hematuria, but size criteria is usually taken at more than 4 cm. We reviewed the literature, but I would like to push a point here is that 4 cm criteria was something taken very old, 1986, 1990 studies. And recently, if the patient is having very minimal symptoms, criteria have been pushed to 6 and 8 cm. Bhatt et al., who gave the largest longitudinal study for the conservative management of AML, have shown that the rupture rates are very low, even with large AML. And perhaps these criteria were defined when CT and other cross-sectional modalities were not available so freely. They have pointed more towards higher vascularity and presence of aneurysms more than 5 mm. In size to be more pertinent criteria for going ahead with the treatment in asymptomatic patients. This aneurysm development is, I think, perhaps more related to the angiographic component not having an elastic lamina in angiomyolipoma vessels inside the tumor. So treatment options, previously nephron sparing surgery was also an important option, but in the current scenario where we have very nice hardware and we can do very selective embolization, selective renal artery embolization has become the treatment of choice. And other options that were previously used were perhaps for complete or radical nephrectomy, which is now very limited use, especially only in the epithelioid variant where we have a higher risk of metastatic component or where there is an involvement of the IVC or the renal vein. More and more evidence is coming for radiofrequency ablation, but perhaps that is still in its early stages. For TSC, this is quite frequently associated with tuberous sclerosis patients who have multiple bilateral AMLs. And in that criteria, the first treatment in asymptomatic patients has now been made to be everolimus by the tuberous sclerosis consensus group. So we should always remember that in such patients, perhaps medical management with mTOR inhibitors, which is supposed to be the pathway for TSC, has also come up. So this was the, we went ahead and performed the DSA and the Simon catheter was used to hook the left renal artery. And when we took the posterior branch of the renal artery, we found that there was a well-defined lesion with tortuous small vessels supplying the tumor. And so we decided to go ahead with the embolization, and we thought it will, the current guidelines suggest very highly selective embolization. The two most important things that are used are PVA particles or liquid embolic agents. Various combinations have been used recently. Bleomycin, lipidol with PVA has been shown to have good result by Wong et al. And even results of Onyx have come up in small studies. Coils are often used in adjunct, especially when they are trying to have a proximal control as well, especially patients who have bled and who have may have some hemodynamic instabilities to just reduce the inflow as well. But the main objective is to get a distal occlusion with PVA particles or liquid embolic agents. Liquid embolic agents provide a very fast and a good distal occlusion, but the only problem sometimes is the risk of reflux. And therefore, it has been defined in the literature as well that a balloon-assisted flow arrest can be used to prevent this reflux even in AML patients in previous studies. So this is what we went ahead. We got a guiding catheter into the cypherous renal guiding catheter into the renal artery, and with a Scepter XC compliant balloon, we were 4 × 11 mm. We got the flow arrest in the vessel, and the angiogram showed the distal vessel filling. We went ahead with the 20% glue injection, and that's when we were ready to bake in the glory of what we had achieved. We were kind of shocked, and we saw that there was clear extravasation, and we might have caused here a artery rupture of the feeding vessel. So what we did, we quickly went ahead to troubleshooting. We got our Scepter XC into the posterior branch, quickly tried to inflate it, got our 27 prograde microcatheter and tried to go into the feeding vessel. We tried to put the first coil within the feeding vessel, but perhaps the rupture was wide proximal and it just flew into the parenchyma. This was followed by just pulling back the microcatheter, and we had to embolize the posterior branch of the renal artery itself. So final result that we got a good control over the bleeding, but the problem was that as what we had started with, we had lost a bit of the nephrons here, because this is what was the whole, exercise was just to prevent these vessels from getting occluded. So that was the loss we suffered because of this complication. And to go back, the culprit was the fact that this balloon, at the time of glue injection, there was a change in the morphology of the balloon. It was a hyper-compliant balloon XC septa. So we were not expecting this, but when we should have realized that in AML, the vessels not only are extremely deep into the tumor, but also the ones which are feeding may have this lack of elastic lamina. And so they are somewhat similar to the intracranial vessels, and there is always a chance of rupture, and you should be very careful with that. So what we could have done instead of having pulled out after having seen that change in morphology, initially we had gone in with the balloon and we had tried to glue embolize the tumor. But when we should have had a clear, careful watch on the balloon morphology, and if we had picked up this change in morphology at the same time, we could have come back injecting the glue and sealed off the lesion. And perhaps if we could have stopped at this, we could have saved even though the nephrons that we lost in this process. So this is not a very common complication. The common complications are more of the post-embolization syndrome. And these are the rates that have been published in the biggest systemic review for AML embolization. And there are non-target embolizations, renal abscess, AML ruptures, and certain very uncommon complications as well. So this is something that we need to keep in mind, that the lamina itself is not as strong as the normal visceral vessels. So at follow-up, we found that the patient did well. There was no significant hematoma. We could see the glue cast and also the small coil that had gone into the parenchyma through the feeding vessel. And the take-home message is that balloon-assisted glue occlusion can be a useful technique to prevent reflux, especially for people who are starting up with the and are not very sure with the glue injection. Careful inflation under fluoroscopy in AML patient is especially important because of the deficiency of elastic lamina, which could have been a reason why even a hypercompliant balloon caused an arterial rupture. And a high degree of suspicion should be there. Any change in morphology should have, had we picked up at that time, we could have taken an invasive action instead of pulling the balloon back. And we should finally be able to clean up our mess and try our best at that. Thank you.
I think it was presented very well managed complication. Any questions from Dr. Abhishek?
I would just also like to ask, by Dr. Akhil, do you routinely use these compliant balloons for such cases, or is it this the specific case where you were using the glue? Yeah.
Since I was I am second year fellow, to prevent, sometimes we are able to manage without the balloon as well. But while injecting, we just thought it would give us a little better control and more confidence in preventing the nephrons, because we thought it's a female patient with a young age with multiple AMLs and might require, if there's a growth of further new development of AMLs, we need to protect as much of nephrons as possible. So the aim was just to prevent the glue refluxing into the vessels that were supplying the part of the nephrons that we finally actually lost. So it's not that we do always, but we are just trying to make sure in this case that we don't have the reflux into the distal vessels.
So what was the name of that balloon which you used?
We use the Scepter XC hypercompliant balloon, sir, 4x11.
I personally, haven't used balloon assisted embolization in these cases. So any comments, Arun or Balaji?
I think it's a good idea to use a balloon, especially the vessels are thin. And so I think just possibly the estimating what amount of embolic agent has to be inserted, ultimately how much pressure has that has led to, possibly would have. But I think it was fairly done case and it just happened.
No, it was excellently managed. I mean, the idea is very good, but how many of us actually use a balloon in such a situation?
Always injecting glue has a learning curve, sir. So initially, everybody might be a little afraid about injecting glue. So until the learning curve, they might be using this as a protection thing.
Okay.
So one of sorry interrupting. One of the attendees asking why he has not chosen for PVA rather than glue.
Why
people have opted for glue rather than why not the PVA?
Sir, liquid embolic agents are give us a much faster control, much more distal control, and the size shrinkage has been found to be better. PVA particles are equally useful. Both, there is a divided literature. We cannot point out why one is better than the other, but it's just that liquid embolic agents sometimes penetrate much better into the deeper levels, and it's a faster procedure. So if we can get used to deployment of the liquid embolics, then there are reports where people suggest that it's better, and it's just a general practice at our institute that we are practicing. But otherwise, both of them have been equally used in literature. It can be used up 300 to 500 micron PVA particles is definitely something that can be used in such cases.
I have actually,
is there any
scripted glue from the PVA? I personally felt that, especially in AML, the results were better with
the glue. Oh. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Akhil. We'll, thank you for an excellent presentation. I think we can move on to the next case.
The next case we have is from Dr. Sanjeev Kumar. Dr. Sanjeev Kumar, you can start presenting your case.
Thank you for inviting me. I hope my slides are visible and I'm audible.
So your slide is clear, but you can be a little louder.
And make it full screen, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Is I'm audible enough?
Better now, yes, sir.
So very good evening to all of you. I'll be discussing about a case of focal coaptation of aorta, a case of multiple misadventures. Moving directly to the case, the clinical detail, this is a 30-year male patient with a history of hypertension, headache, and lower limb fatigue. And on vitals examination, there was significant difference in the upper limb versus the lower limb BP with barely palpable lower limb peripheral pulses. On echocardiography, there was a mild LVH, however, the ejection fraction was preserved, though there was a bicuspid aortic wall. CT was done in this patient, which shows tight focal coaptation. As you can see on these images, the narrowest segment measured nearly around 2 mm in diameter. Rest of the dimensions you can see, and there were multiple significant collaterals which were perfusing the distal circulation. Apart from that, the other vascular territory like the renal or the cerebral were normal, and also there were no evidence of any intracardiac or extracardiac shunt in this patient. So in view of the symptomatic status of this patient and hemodynamically significant narrowing, it became a class 1 indication for intervening in this patient. If you look at the choice of intervention in a patient of the focal coarctation, especially in the adult and adolescent, endovascular technique, that is angioplasty with stenting, is the preferred mode of therapy, and what we prefer to go ahead with. So this is the patient taken on the angiography table from the femoral and for doing the angio from the Bechtel approach. And the lesion was crossed through the femoral approach and the gradient was taken. The gradient was 80 millimeter of mercury. The angiography picture correlated what we see on the CT angiography, and then the lesion was sequentially balloon dilated. It is very important to remember that when we are doing coarctation balloon dilatation, the initial size of the balloon should not exceed 3 times the tightest, narrowest segment of the aorta. And also the largest balloon should never exceed the size of the isthmus. And whenever we want to stent the lesion, the balloon size should be restricted to less than 80% of the stent diameter, which we want to use in this patient. So after the balloon dilatation, this was the initial result. And then we use a 14-4 Tessic 2 balloon, which is a special kind of balloon, which is a very non-compliant balloon, which allows for a uniform dilatation of these non-compliant lesions. And post 14-4 balloon dilatation, you can see this is the result. There is some irregularity at the site of the coarctation, though the gradient has decreased from 80 to 30. However, still the gradient was significant, and in adult patient, we generally go and stent this kind of lesion. So we went ahead, you can see this distal vessel, which was appearing quite normal. We went ahead with the plan to stent this lesion. As far as the choice of a stent is concerned, there is some debate regarding the use of self-expanding versus a covered stent, and we preferred using a covered stent in this situation. And the kind of a stent we choose is called as a CP stent, which is a balloon-mounted stent. The balloon which we typically use here is not a single balloon, but a balloon within a balloon catheter. You can see here there is an inner balloon and then there is an outer balloon. The size of the balloon is determined by the outer balloon diameter. However, the inner balloon diameter is approximately half the outer balloon. The advantage of this inner balloon is that it allows uniform extension or expansion of this stent when this balloon is inflated, and also prevent any inadvertent migration or flaring of this stent, which is often a time seen with a single balloon mounted stent. As already discussed in Dr. Punamia's one of the lecture, how to mount this stent over the balloon, it is very important that the crimping should be done very uniformly in a clockwise manner. And then you should use some protector to advance this balloon mounted stent after crimping into the seat through the wall. Otherwise it will get stiff. So once physically mounted, we negotiated the stent to the desired location. First, the inner balloon was dilated and then the outer balloon was dilated. And you can see that after this, this was the end result, which shows good anti-grade flow across the coarctated segment. And also some of the collaterals which we were seeing earlier could not be seen. However, when we took the gradient, we were surprised that the gradient was still 60. It went from 30 to 60. So we could not understand what is happening here. So we again look at the angios and we can see that there is a dissection which is starting from the distal end of this first stent, which was spiraling throughout the abdominal aorta. And in this angio, if you look carefully, the the aortic bifurcation is completely chinked out with acute occlusion of the left common iliac artery. So the question was what to do now? So we know from our previous experiences that often a time this is the dissection, obstructive dissection, which develop at the distal end of the stent, and a overlapping stent would be beneficial. Now we have on the self only a covered stent at that time, and we thought of deploying a overlapping covered stent with the proximal stent so that the primary entry tier should be taken care of. So we again mounted the stent in the usual manner as we did in the first case. And after careful mounting the stent over the balloon, we started negotiating the balloon and the stent. This is the animation, schematic animation, and I don't have the fluoroscopic images, sorry for that. So when we start delivering the stent balloon combination, what happened during the delivery is that this balloon gets stripped from the stent. Now we were stuck in a situation that if you advance this balloon further, it will totally strip out the stent and it will become a catastrophe. We can do at this point of time that we can remove whole of this assembly either by cutting the hub of the balloon and deploying a larger sheath and taking out everything out, and then again redoing the procedure, or maybe using a telescoping technique and removing the thing, physically mounting the stent again carefully and then again delivering. But what we do in this case is that we just inflated the inner balloon. When we inflated the inner balloon, the stent was partially deployed and get stuck to this balloon. So we have got a force through which we can now push this whole delivery system to the desired location. So once we reach it to the desired location of the proximal stent overlapping, we deployed the outer balloon also so that the proximal portion of the stent get fully deployed. We then deflated this BIB balloon and come to this part of the end and again inflated the balloon so that the whole of the stent get deployed. After this, when we measured the gradient fall back to 10 millimeter of mercury. Though in this angio, you can see that there is a delayed filling of the false lumen. However, there was no significant gradient. When we look at this, again, the abdominal aorta and the bifurcation, though there was some expansion of the infrarenal abdominal aorta, however, still there was no anti-grade flow in the common iliac artery. Though this external iliac artery was filling through multiple collaterals, which was not seen in the earlier angiogram. So the question was now, what to do now? So do we do aggressively first this common iliac artery, or should we have some patience? And we always know that patience pays much than action many a time, not always. So we by also knowing the natural history of this kind of dissection, we know that once the entry tier has been taken care of, this false lumen remodel and the true lumen expand. So we waited for a, also the patient limb was warm at that time and there was no emergency. So we waited to have a watchful expectancy and the patient was followed up. The patient remained, there was no signs of any limb ischemia. And this was the follow-up CT which was done. We saw the patent stent, the entry tier was sealed off, though there was a dissection flap traveling through the thoracoabdominal aorta, but in this angiogram, you can see that the common iliac artery is showing good anti-grade flow with no evidence of any narrowing. So the point to ponder in this case was that I would like to stress that coarctation is typically different from the stenosis of other vascular territory because these lesions are very, very non-compliant lesions and very fibrotic. So they can easily give away if the appropriate sizing of balloon or stent is not done. Often a time, this spiral dissections may not be visible on the 2D angiogram images. And in those cases, we should do DynaCT 3D angio to look for these spiral dissections. Mounting of a stent over balloon is very, very important because if you don't mount it carefully or it get stripped, it will hamper whole of your procedure. And what we do typically now over our experience is that we put some contrast over this balloon. Putting a contrast on this balloon make it sticky and the stent get stick to it unless until a very drastic force is not there to get it separated, and it helps a lot. And also we don't want to treat the images as we seen in the last image of my presentation. We'll depend more on the hemodynamic parameters and clinical status of the patient, and sometime wait-full watching may result in tackling the complication by itself. Thank you very much for your patience evening, and I would love to have questions. Thank you.
See, I think Sanjeev, it was an excellent case, very well managed, and you have given us take home messages very nicely. I don't have any comments to offer on this. Other jury members, if they would like to say anything.
No, it was a very good case, very interesting case, how a case which looks very simple and it causes so much of a problem, but keeping our brain and keep us calm helps us in saving all these patients. Thank you, Dr. Sanjeev.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, jury members.
Thank you. Yeah, let's move on to the next case.
Next presenter we have is Dr. Pankaj Mehta. Dr. Pankaj Mehta, you can start sharing your screen.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes, we can.
Yeah, thank you. Good afternoon, good evening, actually. The case I'm going to present. Hello?
Please proceed.
Yeah. So the case we're presenting actually is not a complication as such of the procedure, but something which we should actually look at the post-procedure imaging which we have. So this is a case of 60-year-old male who's a hypertensive and incidentally detected proximal descending thoracic aneurysm, which was managed conservatively for 2 years before it was considered treatable and the patient was ready for treatment. Just a background, these are the measurements, and this was the kind of aneurysm with a close to type 3 aortic arch. So what we had planned was a total debranching because we didn't have too much of a landing zone. And we would deploy two relay NBS Bolton grafts. And that was the plan. So after debranching, when we did the angiogram, we realized that the surgeon had also banded the aorta here, which changed the measurements entirely. And the stent grafts which we had would be actually too large for this area. And so we confirmed that on a CTA, which we did, and which confirmed to us that the measurements had changed pretty drastically, warranting us to come and, you know, order another set of grafts, which we did, and decided to tackle the problem the next day. So the next day we deployed 236 into 36, 36, 36, 200 mm Bolton relay NBS doing the distal first and then the proximal. We got a decent seal, even though it was not oversized, the proximal one. But the end result was pretty good, and the patient did quite okay, and he was a fairly uneventful post-operative management and was discharged at the end of the week. And on 1 month follow-up, the patient looked fine with no complaints. The patient at the two-month follow-up, close to the two-month follow-up, presented with a pulsatile swelling at the upper sternotomy site. And the CTS surgeon actually had asked for a chest radiograph, which was not really pursued further. And also simultaneously, we asked for a CTA. So this will, okay, we'll look at it now. The thing to note here is, this is the first chest radiograph, which nobody really looked at, we just looked generally. And there's a second radiograph, and you can see that there is a change in the orientation of the second sternal figure of eight suture. So we'll come to that. So a CTA was done, and I'm just showing you a few images in series, which shows the debranching done. This is the main graph which has been put on the ascending aorta. And this is the takeoff of the left subclavian graft. And as we follow it, we find that there is a rent here. And along with the rent, we also notice that these are the sutures which are present here, right next to the area of the rent. And so these are the reconstruction of the same thing, showing you the pseudoaneurysm, which has caused the sternal dehiscence. And this has come through and presented as a chest wall pulsating mass. And once the pseudoaneurysm starts developing, the wires are pulled apart more and more. And so that is what was detected. And solving this, not as much of a problem. We took a brachial axis, and this was repaired with a fluency, 13.5 fluency plus, into 60 mm through the left brachial cut down. So having done that and achieved a decent result, the main take home message here is actually, this is pretty easy to repair. But a lot of times we do not notice things when we do a chest X-ray. In fact, most of the CTS surgeons always ask for chest X-rays, but nobody sees them very carefully. And one of the things we realized that after the first patient, repaired his stent graft, we had them remove the sternal wire, whatever they felt. We insisted on it. It was removed under IV sedation in LA. And the swelling had decreased at 1 week visibly. And the patient is on telephonic follow-up. This happened very close to the 2 month follow-up was right after the pandemic started. So the patient is on follow-up, but he's pretty fine. So sternal dehiscence actually is a pretty deadly complication of median sternotomies, and non-infective sternal dehiscence is not very uncommon. And there's a lot of literature, if we search for it, on sternotomy wires would get cut due to various causes and create, they present in various ways, like projecting a right ventricle injury or presenting by migrating into pulmonary arteries with hemoptysis or cardiac tamponade or even ventricular-atrial fistulas. A lot of presentations have been there. But what, like this was one case where they found a wire, just a chip, plain X-ray shows this wire projecting into the RV, and this actually created a ventricle to aorta fistula. But closest we come is this case, which is an aortic graft pseudoaneurysm secondary to fractures from the wires, which is exactly what had happened in our case. This was in there, the case which I just showed you from the journal. The wire here, which broke, actually created the injury and led to a large pseudoaneurysm here and a big hematoma. So generally, we realize that a patient who has an excessive cough, abnormal chest wall stresses, or is ventilator dependent for a long time, or underlying COPD, there is a possibility of sternal dehiscence because these wires may not hold because they are subjected to undue stress because of constant coughing. And we will not raise a doubt on the surgical skill here because that's not our field to talk about. So anyway, so once we have this, I think we have to get into the habit of looking into our imaging. So in our case, the first month follow-up of chest X-ray showed intact wires. Now, a lot of centers, what they do is in the first month follow-up after any kind of stent grafting procedure, they would like to have a CTA at 1 month and then 6 months, then yearly thereon. I mean, that was what quite a few recommendations are, which we didn't do, but a lot of people will take an X-ray. But our take is that if you take an X-ray and if you find that you have a sternal wire or some change in the appearance of the wires or the weaving pattern which they have done. And so we must image at that point of time. So it's difficult to say whether the sternal dehiscence led to the wire fracture or the wire fracture due to abnormal stresses led to the sternal dehiscence and formation of PSA post-injury. But either way, it's highly likely that injury to the graft is because of the broken wire lying against the graft at the site of tear. And one of the reasons, I think, especially in cases where you're doing a zone zero deployment, when you have a prevascular space which is so tight and you have a lot of these debranching grafts moving along that, I think we should pay special attention during our follow-ups on x-rays. And if we do a CTA, on a CTA of the relationship of these grafts, the wires, especially broken wires or jagged wires, or highly angulated sharp wires. So that's just a small take-home message. The wire abnormalities are pretty common. Radiographic abnormalities will definitely precede the clinical diagnosis. So let's not waste the chest radiograph. Look at it very carefully at every follow-up. And if we find that there's some change, we must do a CTA for further evaluation and just to pick up a problem which can be solved earlier than before. Thank you very much.
I think, Pankaj, it was a very good case, good take-home message. But how many times we have seen this kind of situation?
Yeah, exactly. We see quite a... I have reviewed a few x-rays after we had this. And we find that sometimes the sternal wires do change the shape. And that is why, even though this is pretty rare, it's important to image at that time. That's what we realized with this case. If we had done the... the first month CTA and we found that the wire is in contact, but of course the wire was not broken that time. But if we find a broken wire, definitely we should investigate further, especially if it's in the vicinity. Because as I was going through the literature, there are quite a few cases which have been presented. There are series actually of people having these kind of problems. So it's better safe than sorry. That's what we feel. So look into our x-rays properly, and if we find anything changed, better to do the next obvious investigation, which is CTA.
Yeah.
Just a message, yeah.
No, excellent take-home message and a good learning point. What I'm saying is, should we do a CTA at first month rather than just doing a plain chest x-ray?
I think that would be entirely up to the center. Because I see a lot of people who do mandatory a one-month follow-up CTA after any major procedure, especially like a debranching or something. Because our first instinct was that this patient had one of the debranch grafts which gave way or one of those, but we realized after the CTA that it was this wire. So it may be a good habit, 1 month CTA, even though it adds radiation, significant radiation,
yes.
1 month CTA. But in this case, the presentation was close to the second month. So you can never predict these things, I feel. But a 1 month CTA is a decent follow-up protocol for any major aortic debranching procedure and grafting.
Yeah, thank you very much. Anything from Arun?
No, sir. Nice case.
Very nice case, Pankaj, as usual. Thank you very much. I think we can move on to the next case.
Shall we move on to the next presenter now?
Yes, please.
The next presentation we have is from Dr. Yajush Jain. Dr. Yajush, if you're with us, you can start your presentation.
Thank you. Just a second. Am I visible? And
yes, your audio and video both are clear.
Okay, so the slides are visible?
Not yet. You have to share the screen.
Just a second. There's some error. Just a second.
Once you click on that green icon which says share screen, click on
it's showing desktop, yes. And after that it's showing system preferences something. I guess there's some error.
The pop-up should have, the first icon should have written screen. You click on screen and then click on share.
Okay. It needs me to leave the meeting for a second before I can start sharing my screen.
I think other presenter can present, then Dr. Yajish can present it later. Next presenter, please.
So we will ask Dr. Naveen Chandrasekhar to present in the meantime. And Dr. Yajish, you can call us in case you need any assistance.
Sorry for the trouble.
No problem. Dr. Naveen, can you start?
Yes, I am here. I'm just sharing my screen. Good evening, everybody. Good evening, faculty.
Good evening.
Are my slides visible?
Yes, Naveen, you can start.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Myself, Dr. Naveen. I am a fellow in Tata Memorial Hospital, Bombay. First of all, I would like to thank everybody, the ISBS faculty, the consultants at Tata Memorial Hospital for providing me this opportunity to present a very simple case. I'll just rush through. This is a case of retrieval of accidental broken diagnostic catheter while doing a DJ stenting. So this was my first experience of a complication management as a resident in IR. So coming to a brief case history, this was a 76-year-old male who had a comorbidities of hypertension and ex-alcoholic for 5 years with a very poor ECOG status of 2 and a fragility of only 2 floors. His chief complaints were complaint of swelling in bilateral inguinal region for 3 months and multiple nodules, skin nodules over the chest. So he had also undergone a PET CT which was showing multiple nodes with SUV of 4.7. And also showing a low-grade metabolism in the prevascular. He also had nodes in the prevascular and bilateral cervical regions. So the biopsy was done from the inguinal nodes, which turned out to be a Merkel cell carcinoma with metastatic neurostenum mediastinum. So he was having a creatinine of 6.7, for which he underwent an ultrasound QOB, which showed bilateral hydronephrosis, and this was due to the abdominal nodes, the retroperitoneal nodes, which was abutting and compressing the ureter. So he was referred to IR for an emergency PCN, bilateral PCN, which went uneventful. So this is a static fluoroscopic image showing bilateral PCN catheters in V2. So followed by this, the patient was planned for a DJ stenting. So this is an image where we can see that the catheters are in V2 and the gram is showing opacification of the pelvic calcium system. So what went wrong is while exchanging the pigtail catheter with a stiff wire, the diagnostic catheter broken into the pelvic calcium system. So this is what went wrong. And I was the only one which was available at that time. So it was kind of a panic situation for me, but definitely I got it too. So we exchanged the initial PCN catheter with a sheath and took a new access from the lower pole calyx. Then tried all the possible maneuvers, tried snaring, tried looping with the wire, stiff wire, everything couldn't come up to. Finally, we could railroad it kind of from the sheath, could negotiate a terminal wire into the broken catheter. So these are the images where you can see that through the sheath, I was trying to just cross the broken fragment catheter and get into the axis. So finally, this was the image showing a terminal wire passed into the broken catheter. And this is how this was made. A very simple case for the initial beginners like me in the initial days, a retrieval of a broken catheter. So this was how it was retrieved. And finally, I could do a DJ stenting on the same side which was affected. So the take home message from this case would be like not to panic for the new residents like me. And there are multiple options for retrieval. You can use any snare, glue, or stent. You can use also a balloon assisted snaring. Thank you.
Yeah, Balaji, any comments?
Very good case, sir. Like as a resident, as he said, like, these things come at the night. When we were fellow, I also remember like we used to do in KEM. So it's good that you did not panic and you bailed out the procedure. And yes. Intervention is all about like, managing the complication, like, procedures, it will be easy. Everybody will be teaching you. But how to manage these complications is the most important things. That's well done, case, Dr. Naveen.
Yeah, I must compliment you, Dr. Naveen, being alone and being the first complication, it has really managed very well.
Thank you. Actually, these are broken tip. These are beacon tip catheter, no?
Yes, must be.
A black one.
It's a beacon tip catheter from Cook.
Yes, it was a beacon catheter from Cook.
Yes, and most of the time they are ETO catheters.
Oaks catheters, yeah.
They are prone to break these. Don't use these catheter.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Actually, we should not use, very rightly, Johan, I think you are right. These are very prone to breaking, you know, break. Everywhere.
Especially ETO catheter, beacon tip, they are very prone to break.
Yes.
Now they are completely out of the market now.
Now we are not getting.
This was one of the odds catheter which we had. Yes.
Almost like everybody has faced that complication, I believe, and we have stopped.
Yes. I don't know. Since 2005 to 2010, there was not such a problem. But suddenly what happened after 2010, everything was broken.
They realized that we are reusing the catheter a lot of times.
No, I agree. Initially, when we started using, this was from Cook, actually, first one to introduce this. Very good catheters. Yeah, but later on, we started having trouble with this.
Yes.
Even uterine artery catheter, same problem, you know, that tip will sometimes break. So, okay, thank you very much, Dr. Naveen.
Thank you so much.
Very nicely managed. There are no questions, and I think we can move on to the next presentation.
Moving on to the next presentation, which is from Dr. Ketan Gaikwad. Dr. Ketan?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, you're clear.
Thank you. Just a minute, I'll share my screen.
Sure.
Yeah. Can you see the screen now?
Yes, the screen is visible.
Okay.
Can you introduce yourself?
Yes, sir. I'm Ketan. I'm working as a consultant interventional radiologist in Queen Elizabeth University Hospital, Glasgow. Thank you, everyone. And thank you, team, for having me here. And it was a pleasure to listen to everyone who spoke before me and the moderators. So it's a very small case, easily treated. It's interesting how the complication happened and the events that led to the complication. That is more interesting, I guess. And it has some teaching point in it. So we had a patient, 32-year-old lady, and incidentally detected splenic artery aneurysm. Serial follow-up imaging was done and there was minor change in the size. The aneurysm was increasing. So this is the CT surface rendered image showing splenic artery and splenic artery aneurysm. I agree that the aneurysm was not very big, but as she was a childbearing aged lady and these aneurysms are known, the visceral aneurysms are known to increase in size during pregnancy. So it was decided in the MDT that we are going to treat it. So it was a routine procedure. Our senior trainee started it. He took right common femoral artery retrograde puncture. SIM-1 catheter was inserted to hook the celiac artery and a prograde 2.7 French was used. 6 millimeter detachable hydrocoils were used. So this is a hand injection in the celiac artery through 5 French catheter showing splenic artery aneurysm. So we proceeded to deploy the coils one by one. In total, 5 coils were used, but this is the picture after the second coil. There is slight aberration. I'll say that there was no microcatheter. This picture is after the deployment of coil and removing the microcatheter away. There is some aberration in the picture and we'll come later to it, like what was wrong and what went wrong really. There was some problem while deploying the second coil, just to say. We went on to pass another microcatheter. The first one was removed as there was some problem. Passed another microcatheter and 5 coils were deployed in total. There was relatively good packing of the aneurysm back door and front door, I'll say. So we removed both the catheters. This is the picture of coil cast after removing of the catheter. So if you notice, the picture on the left hand side is one that is with the catheters and showing the coil clasped when the catheters were there in situ. We removed the catheters and picture on the right hand side is the picture of coil cast after removal of the catheter, you will notice that one coil is missing. So we started screening the abdomen and pelvis just to locate the coil, and the coil was seen in the iliac artery here. So the salvage was pretty straightforward. We took a left common femoral artery puncture, snared the coil out, and this was the last fluoro picture that we had. Both the sheets were removed, puncture closure devices used, patient was sent to the ward, and everybody was happy, but it was not over yet. We started discussing this case in a meeting on the same day, in a mortality meeting, a morbidity and mortality meet. Someone noticed something wrong with the picture. So if you see closely, there is a thin wire and this detachment zone here, and a part of the coil which is still remaining. So this thin wire is, it's part of the pusher wire which has remaining inside. So why did that happen is interesting. So we got the patient back. We did a CT scan just to understand where exactly this metal filament was running into, and what sort of next puncture should be, whether right or left, in order to snare it out. Again, we took the left side puncture, snared the thin filament out. So why did it happen is interesting. So when the senior trainee, he was detaching the coils, the second coil, it wouldn't detach with the detachment controller, and it could not be retrieved back into the microcatheter by pulling the pusher wire, as there was resistance. So what he did in panic was he rotated the coil vigorously, the pusher wire, and in hope that it would detach, the coil would detach. And what had happened was that there was a break in the pusher wire rather than at the detachment zone, and some part of the pusher wire was remaining inside in the catheter and in situ. So this is the picture after rotation of the pusher wire. So you can see the microcatheter was removed. The only thing there was inside was a 5 French catheter in the celiac trunk, but you can still see the thin pusher wire going all the way up to the coil cast, and there is this detachment zone which is still there. So the microcatheter was removed. There was some part of the pusher wire which was in hand of the trainee, and he thought that, you know, everything is fine. This thin wire was not noticed at that time. Even in the last picture, you can see that this is a new microcatheter passed in through the 5 French catheter. You can see this wire running parallel to this microcatheter. So when finally both the catheters were removed, the proximal end of this pusher wire was stuck in the 5 French catheter, and it pulled the whole coil out. Because if you see the coil which was pulled out into the aorta along with the catheters is not the last coil, the number 5 coil, but a number 2 coil which was pulled back. So take home message from this case is that you should know your device, because each deployable coil has different mechanism to deploy. It is important to use right size and type of coil. Right size is important, because if I want to occlude artery, I would rather use appropriately sized coils in tandem rather than overlapping undersized or oversized coils. And you should not deploy with excess force. That is important, because these coils are very thin. Even when we say it is 018 or 035 inch coil, the actual diameter of the thinnest filament, the diameter when we say 018, it is actually a diameter of the secondary curve of the wire. And the actual wire the coil is made up of is much thinner than that. So it's a very delicate thing. And when it is stretched by rotating or by using force, broken using force, it's very difficult to retrieve back, or it is the main thing which can cause complication later. And you should stay vigilant till the end of the procedure and after the procedure, even if after initial success, and go through the stored images of the case to rule out any minor aberrations which we may miss during the procedure. In this case, the thin filament which was completely not noticed. and have collaborative relations with colleagues, because I think this patient would have gone home with a thin filament in her aorta and dangling in her common iliac arteries if one of our colleagues didn't notice that thin filament there. So, thank you.
Yes, Arun.
Very interesting case and very keen observation and understanding the things and will out the things.
Dr. Ketan, as you said, like this is a very important point to be taken, that after the angio or after the successful completion of the procedure, we have to, before we remove the sheath, sit there, yeah, see all the runs, like, you know, some dissection might be there, some, you know, something might be there. So it's always better that, you know, we see all those runs and then once we are satisfied, then we go for the removal of the sheath.
Yeah.
Very good point to be taken.
Just to say that, you know, we did a few angiograms later at the end of the procedure just to make sure that the splenic artery aneurysm was treated adequately, you know, even after, you know, getting all the coils out and everything.
Okay, and, Dr. Abhishek, any comments? You're not audible.
You have disabled your this one, Abhishek.
Am I audible now, sir?
Yeah.
It's a pretty well managed case. And I think the complication which we have saw over here is possibly because of not knowing your hardware well. And at the end of the procedure, I think the resident or the doctor who has put these coils in for the embolization, he has not informed you or something like the.
No, sir.
Is it like he has not informed the sim? Okay.
He didn't notice at all.
This thing. He didn't notice.
I mean, he didn't notice till the till he had resistance while removing the catheter, and by the time he noticed it, the coil was completely retrieved into the aorta. So at that point, the consultants were involved.
Okay, consultant were there.
Yeah, but I agree. I mean, I just believe that any complication can happen at any stage of your career.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think Ketan, very good learning point. Though I think once he was pulling it out, it's very unusual to get the broken pushing. And a very, very unusual something happened. And yeah, it's a very rare case. And anyway, picked up by your colleague and nicely managed thereafter.
Actually, it can be happened by, sir, using excessive force for the coil deployment. But when this kind of situations arises, rather than pushing from the coil pusher, one can use a saline flush from the microcatheter. So that is more safe option rather than pushing hard the coil through the coil pusher.
Otherwise, backside of the terminal. Coil, so they are detachable.
Detachable coil. So we couldn't really do that. I mean, the pusher wire was attached to the coil.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Ketan. Thank you very much.
And, thanks a lot, sir.
We move on to the next presentation.
Sir, please advise if we can take the presentation from Dr. Yajush Jain now.
Definitely.
Sure. Dr. Yajush, are you ready?
Yes. I guess the screen is sharing now. Is it visible?
Yes, it started. Yes.
Thank you. So, good evening, everyone, and thank you to the ISVIR selection committee for selecting this case. And so, I'll present a case of a torn guide wire coating during percutaneous drain placement. So percutaneous drain placement is a fairly common technique which we are using every now and then in patients of liver abscess and pancreatitis. A case of acute necrotizing pancreatitis presented to our hospital emergency with severe abdominal pain, fever and breathlessness. And she had raised TLC serum amylase and lipase level. She was admitted and then planned for a percutaneous drain placement. So this was the CCT abdomen. And here we can see a large peripancreatic collection, which is extending into the left pararenal space and up to the pelvic location. And if we look carefully, we can also see a descending colon nearby that collection. So we planned for an ultrasound and fluoro-guided drain placement, basically a trocar placement, a 28 French trocar placement. And initially, we took a puncture and the contrast was injected to delineate the cavity of the collection. A wire was inserted and in a caudal to cranial fashion in order to obtain the maximum drainage. But after a sequential dilatation, when the contrast moved out, I could see a thin thread or lace-like structure inside the cavity, which was not there previously. And when I was pulling the wire out, pulling the needle out, so there was a little resistance. After pulling the wire out, I checked the wire and there was a torn fragment of the coating, which was not visible there. And so at this time, I tried to take this out using an artery forceps. And after multiple attempts, I was not able to take this piece out. So I called Ajisar for help. And so we went ahead with the proper drain placement. And after the drain placement, we tried to rotate the drain and look the proximity of this torn fragment to the drain. And as in this video, we can see that the fragment is just nearby the drain. As we can see, the fragment is moving in compliance with the drain. So we went ahead, we used a wire and a sheath, and we used a snare. We made an extra hole in the draining catheter. Through that extra aperture, we went inside and we took the torn fragment through the snare. We just snared it out. So this was the final outcome of the case. And so the basic teaching point in this case is that although the percutaneous drain placement is a easy technique and every fellow is doing it every now and then, but one thing we have to remember that the needle which we are using has a beveled edge, and when we are using a guide wire which has a hydrophilic coating, so we should remember that sometimes this coating can get stuck into the beveled edge, which can lead to the tearing of these guide wire, this coating. So important point is to remember that we should not force the guide wire out, rather we should rotate it in a slow fashion and try to take the needle out. And finally, we can dilate it to 6 and 8 French, and using an 8 French dilator, we can take the wire out and without leaving any fragments inside. That's it. Thank you.
I think very important point is that if you read the literature of Terumo guide wire, actually it is written that if you use a metallic needle, it might get struck. So you have to adequately size it, you know? Yes. So that problem is always there, though we very commonly use it. And that's a problem with Terumo and metallic needle. Any comments, Balaji?
So we can go forward.
Okay. Any other comments from any other jury members?
In this case, basically the problem was that whenever we used to pull the wire inside a beveled edge needle, so we want to reposition the wire into some other part of the cavity. At that time, the hydrophilic coat will get into the beveled edge and it gets torn there. So the problem happens so many times because we are not using so many times only the thermo wire. Thermo wire is used when the cavity, we have to navigate deeper into the cavity or some other part of the cavity. So if this kind of problem happened, always push the thermo in deep into the cavity and dilate it from 6 to 8 to 10 French so that it can torn part can easily come out through the dilator. And then we can put the stiff wire and then we can dilate and we can put another drain. But if this kind of problem happened, then we should not put another needle. We should dilate it on that only. We should go ahead with the our PCD and make some extra hole in the PCD. And through PCD, we can go by any catheter or any thermo wire. We can go through that eye into the that PCD into the collection, and we can get hold of that wire and we can retrieve it back. So my message to the juniors is just don't go for another puncture. Just go by that PCD only and you can retrieve that that small part of the wire inside.
No, it was excellent, very good retrieval. I think Ajit must compliment you on that. But I was just mentioning the mismatch and the precaution to be taken. Chauhan, any comments from you?
नहीं सर बिल्कुल सही बोला उन्होंने एक्चुअली जैसे अजीत ने बोला वैसे ही करते हैं इट हैपेंस सर ऑल द टाइम व्हेन वी स्टार्ट आवर कैरियर इट हैपेंस इन द फीमोरल आर्टरी आल्सो सर समटाइम्स
यस
वी आर यूजिंग टर्मो वायर रादर देन द स्ट्रिप वायर
यस यस सो नो इट वाज वेरी वेल मैनेज्ड आई थिंक अजीत एक्सीलेंट
आई वुड गिव अनदर एडवाइस दैट इफ यू आर इजीली एबल टू टेक दीस स्मॉल वायर्स इफ यू फील कंफर्टेबल यू कैन टेक इट इजीली Otherwise, even if you leave it there, possibly it might not cause much harm to the patient. So there should be a level of aggressiveness to.
Yes. So my question, actually, I was avoiding this. Arun, you have mentioned it. Should we have left it inside?
So I think. I would say that if it comes out easily, like in this case, it was not difficult. But creating a lot of aggravating further the problems by doing various procedures. So if it comes out easily, if it doesn't comes out, wait for some time. There are many other methods. If it gets infected somehow, there are many other methods. So there should be a balance between your aggressiveness and your proactiveness.
Okay, thank you.
We should be careful, not in the collection.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. I think we move on to the next case.
The next case is being presented by Dr. Sandeep. Dr. Sandeep?
Yes.
Can you please start?
Okay. No, Yon, I guess this is my last case for today. So this is a patient who had an ablation done for a liver lesion and had a complication. So I'll just describe the complication. There was an interesting technique in trying to take care of it. All right. So there we go. So this is a 78-year-old female who had a pancreatic adenocarcinoma, underwent Whipple's in 2016. 3 years later, she developed metastases. Two lesions, segment 4, segment 8, underwent an uneventful microwave ablation. And a follow-up scan about a month later showed now a new lesion there. And they thought that we'll probably have to do another ablation there as well. So taken up for ablation, but in 3 weeks time, when he did a intra-procedural CT, found actually the lesion was no more than 1.5, actually doubled in size to almost 3 centimeters. Didn't change their plan. We went ahead with the ablation itself with the microwave ablation, and you can see we've got a very good burn out there. Now this lesion, as you can see, is very close to the dome of the diaphragm. There was no intent to create any artificial ascites to actually kind of prevent any damage to the diaphragm. So anyway, patient was discharged and came back 2 weeks later to ED with fever and shortness of breath. Chest X-ray showed a large pleural effusion and was admitted under respiratory medicine because that was the time, you know, COVID was beginning to come in. So they immediately got in, got chest tubes in, was undergone all the swabs. And thereafter, chest tubes were removed because effusion had resolved, but then came back again. The effusion was coming in and out, and they kept putting tubes, in fact, ding-donging for almost 2 months until they actually reached out to us to find out if there's any cause for this effusion that we can think of. Now, if you look at it temporally, because of the recent ablation, it could be related to that, since it's close to the diaphragm, there could have been a traumatic injury. It could be to a bile, because the color also a little funny, chromish looking color. So just asked them to do a serum bilirubin to a pleural ratio, and he found the ratio was more than 3 to confirm bilothorax, and the culture grew some really strange organism, never heard of this, but something that they were taking care of. So obviously next thing was get an MRCP done, which showed that there was indeed a right anterior duct, a mild dilatation there, probable stricture here, the anterior duct, couldn't see the right posterior duct that clearly. And then we proceeded with thought we'll ask them to do a biliary drainage done. And that is the PTC, the initial two-stick method, because on the ultrasound, we really couldn't see the dilatation of the duct. See, entered through a segment 5 duct, there's the initial picture. And then it spills over to the segment 8. And you can see clearly there is some narrowing at the segment 5-8 junction, as well as of the right anterior duct by itself before it enters into the bowel. But we really can't see the leak as yet. So we weren't too sure because this duct is not filled, this one is not filled. So all we did was we actually get a catheter up from 5 to 8 and injected contrast at slightly higher pressure. Now you can see that there was a demonstrable leak. So the obvious reason for the leak was an obstructed system. This leak, if it was unobstructed, probably would have resolved and wouldn't have created this issue of pleural of bilothorax at all. So now the question is, how do we treat this? Well, typically, we would obviously like to get, given this view that there is obstruction at these two levels and the fact there is a leak somewhere here, we would like to get two tubes in. So get a wire into your segment 8 duct and get a segment 5 also wire down. And then we place two drains. And if that takes care of the leak, then obviously next step would be to stent them since this patient is a new lesion and is moving towards palliative care now. So the interesting part was when we tried to hit the segment 8 duct, we did manage to get in into the duct, but getting the wire in was an issue. And we used all kinds of wires and finally landed up with the Terumo gold tip microwire. You can see here that it keeps going up, but they managed to get a loop down. And despite the loop going down, we really couldn't get our dilator assembly in. In fact, the dilator assembly would stop at that right angle with the duct. If I perforated the duct and invariably we lost the access. And then inject contrast from down, we're unable to opacify the duct again. So probably some blood clot there. So now what do we do? Well, we thought the target of that duct was really very small. That was probably the only duct target that we could see. So why don't we make the target bigger? And that's what we did. We, from that approach, we placed from the segment 5 to 8 approach, we placed in Amplatz gooseneck snare. And then we used that as a target, which was much bigger than the 2 millimeter duct that we were trying to get. And that's a picture that we're advancing the needle. It goes into the hoop of the gooseneck snare. We catch the snare to make sure that we've got the needle. Then we place the wire through that needle and then grab it out from the snare and go down to segment 8. So now, segment 5, sorry. So now you've got a through and through access, which makes it much easier now to pass your transitional dilators and achieve the biliary drainage. And that was indeed what was done. That's the acoustic or NEFSET outer dilator going in with one wire down now into the bowel and one into the segment 8. We managed to get two tubes in. That's in the segment 8 and segment 5. And that achieved the drainage. So what happened from there on is the drain output from the biliary drain was about 200 odd mils a day, which is corresponding to the segments we were draining. Test output dropped from 200 mils to almost 5 mils per day. So because he was for palliative care, I thought we'll do a palliative stenting. And if the biliary leak is still there, we might even consider embolizing that portion of the bile duct. So just to demonstrate the leak first, whether it was still there, we got the back up here, couldn't see the leak. And we used an occlusion cholangiogram using a Fogarty balloon, inflated it. So you get higher pressure into the biliary system. And now we're certainly seeing that the leak has resolved and there's really no need to do an embolization. All we had to do then was place two stents in segment 5 and segment 8 and get the drainage done. And that is the picture in the end. Now that's the area that was the small perforation that occurred, but the intrahepatic biliary dilatation had disappeared. Contrast goes down completely. So follow-up 1 month later, small residual complex effusion, which remained static for almost 3 months or so till the end of a patient's life. So take-home points are that protection of diaphragm with the help of artificial ascites, and if you're wanting to avoid any lung damage, an artificial pleural effusion should be considered ablating hepatic dome lesions. Whenever there is hepatic breach and the patient has persistent effusion, bilothorax is to be suspected, and biliary diversion or stenting is an effective treatment in these patients. Thank you.
Yeah, Arun, I think it was managed extremely well.
Extremely well, and I always love his using this snare and then puncturing in all sorts of cases. I have seen Punimiya's cases in TIPS, EHPU, everything, and it is really every year I learn something from his cases.
No, excellent, excellent cases. So Sandeep, as usual,
has 4 cases, and all cases were so fascinating that in every case, there was some definite learning point.
So I think Sandeep, as usual, I think it was excellent learning point. Very goodly, very nicely
managed. Thank you. Always a pleasure.
Yeah. Sandeep sir, thank you so much for taking time and making everybody learn out of your experience.
So Dr. Punamya, when we were doing it, at that time there was presence of any residual malignancy after these ablations, or it was just palliative stenting?
So no, it was actually, the plan was to ablate because it was more curative intent. Mm-hmm. Until pyrethorax happened and we found a new lesion. Hello?
New lesion.
Yeah, found a new lesion, and then we thought that it is obviously not, this is a very aggressive near of the disease and it's very likely to have more and more meth. So then they switch from curative to palliative intent. Yeah.
One question, sir. Was the puncture was ultrasound guided or fluoroscopy guided in the segment 5 duct, sir?
I'm sorry, I missed something. There's a
sir, the puncture
lag out here.
Yeah,
the
ductal puncture was fluoroscopy guidance or ultrasound guidance, sir?
I think we frozen the screen. I'm so sorry.
So as I know, Dr. Punamya, he most of the time his biliary punctures are classical techniques, and he is master in this. The way he has punctured segment 5 and then later taken the segment 8 duct. So most of the time, he take the fluoroscopic punctures, and he's very good in that.
Okay. Abhishek, you want to say something?
Absolutely fine, sir.
Okay. I think, great Sandeep, talk. We really thank you for the excellent cases, and nice to see you again after a long time. Yeah. Thanks
nice to see you, all of you.
Thank you.
You are not eligible for the prize.
So, Arti, any other cases left, or we are done with this session?
Yes, sir. We are still left with 3 more cases. Mm-hmm. In fact, 4. And Dr. Sunil Karmat, have you been able to join? I can still see joining in front of his name. Dr. Sunil, are you with us now?
If any other speaker is ready, you can ask him to present it.
Sure. In that case, I think we can move on to Dr. Abhishek Bansal. Dr. Abhishek Bansal's presentation, we will have to run from the console from our side. Dr. Abhishek Bansal, if you're ready, can we start? Dr. Abhishek? Can you hear us, Dr. Abhishek Bansal?
Dr. Karthikeyan is there. He has to present.
Yeah. Okay. Dr. Karthikeyan, in that case, we will start with you.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. I'm Karthikeyan. I'm an IR resident from Kovai Medical Center. Today, I'm going to present on a hybrid TEVR for a complicated type B aortic dissection, where we encountered a complication both in the surgery as well as in the endovascular procedure, and finally, we rescued it without any problems. So this is a case of a 55-year female who's a known hypertensive, presented with acute chest pain. And on imaging, she was a type B dissection, and she was having a left renal malperfusion with increasing serum creatinine levels, and the entity here was located just distal to the left subclavian artery. Since it was it was diagnosed as a complicated type B dissection, and she was planned for further treatment. So on reviewing the images for planning, she had a right vertebral which was hypoplastic, and left vertebral was a dominant one. Also, and as we focus within the brain, we can see the right vertebral is ending as a posterior pica, that is a posterior inferior cerebral artery, and left vertebral is a sole artery forming a left vertebro-basilar system. Hence, she had a single dominant left vertebral artery forming a vertebro-basilar system, and right vertebral artery was ending as a pica. She was planned for a hybrid TEVR. The initial first stage was to transpose the subclavian artery to the left common carotid, and then followed by the second step to do a TEVR. And their measurements were supposed 28 to 29, and within the landing zone, and the arch was quite good enough for landing the graft. And she was sent for the surgery by a cardiothoracic surgeon. And so after the cardiac thoracic surgeon, we shifted the patient to cath lab and we started with a picta aortogram to check all the grafts and everything. It looks okay. As we can see here, this is the left common carotid and this is the left common carotid and the left subclavian artery, which was bypassed and it was normal. The graft is normal and bilateral carotids are normal. But as we can see here, the right vertebral artery, which is coming from the subclavian artery, is visualized but the left vertebral artery is not visualized and the surgeon is not sure exactly where he is ligated. Probably he is ligated at the level of origin of the left vertebral artery. And in the CT also was confirmed the left vertebral artery is arising from the subclavian artery. So, and we can see here the right vertebral artery is ending in a pica, not forming any basilar circulation. So before proceeding with the T-bar, so we have to finally take an intracranial shot to see what is happening in the brain because that determines the prognosis for the patient. So we proceed with the right brachiocephalic angiogram, which confirmed that right vertebral artery is terminating as pica and there is some basilar reformation through the right common carotid. So we did a biplane angiogram of a right common carotid angiogram. And we can see the basilar artery is reformed all the way up to the V4 segment of the vertebral artery through the dominant posterior communicating artery. And it was with a good perforatus, all the circulation up to the V4 segment is maintained. So, and this is the left common carotid angiogram, which is there is no contribution to basilar circulation. And the left subclavian graft and the rest of the left subclavian artery is filling well. So hence she had a good cross circulation of the basilar artery. So we decided to proceed with the T-bar and we placed the landing zone was measuring around 28 to 29 mm. Hence we oversized to 15% and planned to place a 30 to 200 millimeter Reliant Medtronic graft. And so we just placed, and this is after placing the graft, we checked with the pictail. And we can see that we have initial positioning of the graft is exactly at the left common carotid artery. And so we started to deploy. The graft deployment was not very smooth, probably due to some technical issue within the graft. And so this is after the graft deployment. As we can see, there is a forward mild jumping of the graft, which has happened. And there was a partial coverage of the left common carotid artery. So this is an aortogram, which is showing the partial coverage of the left common carotid artery. And see, we measured the arterial gradient between the two upper limb, and there is a significant gradient between the two upper limbs. So hence it was a partial coverage. So probably it could have happened because the graft deployment was not very smooth because of some technical issue. And the other thing is to avoid graft jumping, we can induce hypotension. But in these cases, we avoid it because the patient's posterior circulation is dependent on the posterior communicating artery. Hence, we prefer to avoid hypotension for the graft deployment. And we didn't. And it was, and since the landing zone was very good enough, we were less expected this thing would occur. So hence, we have to salvage this. Hence, since it was a partial coverage, so we attempted to cannulate the left common carotid using a Bernstein catheter and angle turbo, and we could cannulate the left common carotid, and we confirmed the position, and we exchanged it for the extra stiff implants wire. So after that, we dilated with the 7 mm balloon to check for the graft pliability, whether it is okay to put a stent, and it was the graft was pliable enough. And so finally, we put a rescue stenting with using a balloon expandable 7x37 mm stent. And so now this is a check aortogram, which is showing a good forward flow within the aorta, not much of endoleak, and the forward flow within the left common carotid and left subclavian was good. And the patient was extubated well, extubated without any complications. And the patient was started on anticoagulant clexane and antiplatelets since we have put a bilayer stenting. And she was discharged in a stable condition without any issues. And the serum creatinine also improved the subsequent days. And this is after the 2 months follow-up. So where we can see the stent is patent without any problems and the false lumen is completely disappeared. And when there is some residual false lumen, which is at the level of the suprarenal location, but the total aortic diameter was within the there's no interval increase in the total aortic diameter. And as we can see, the left renal artery is also perfusing well. So she was just put on follow-up with an antiplatelets. So the take-home message is, even with the meticulous planning, there is always a risk of coveraging of an arch vessel when we are doing a T-bar procedure. Hence, we should always be ready for the bailout procedures. Like in this case, since it was a partial coverage, we could able to cannulate it and put a stent. If it was completely covered, then we should have been ready for in situ fenestration or surgical bypass if it is needed. And also, if you are planning for a hybrid procedure, always make sure in the pre-op aortic imaging, make sure you include the brain to understand what is a cross-circulation of the circle of Willis, which is of vital importance in case of any surgical misadventure which is happening. And always make sure you start with the pectoral aortogram before starting deploying the graft to ensure all the grafts are patterned and nothing is going wrong. Thank you.
Dr. Johan, any questions? Dr. Chandramohan? So I think it was a nicely presented case, and no more questions. We can proceed with the next.
Kohu, can I have my slides? Actually, I had to answer that.
Yes, sir. I will start playing your slides.
Thanks. Good evening, everyone. So my case is a very basic case, biopsy, and we encountered an uncommon complication. We all have seen pneumothoraces, but in this particular case, we had a huge septal emphysema also. So this just case shows how intervention radiologists should be aware of this complication, and we should just follow it. So this is my case, massive subcutaneous emphysema neuromediastinum after percutaneous lung biopsy. Next slide, please. Who can have the next slide? So he was a 69-year-old gentleman, a chronic smoker, and this is a huge right lung mass. And it was actually abutting the oblique fissure onto the right side. So next slide, please. So we planned for the CT-guided biopsy, and we wanted to avoid the oblique fissure. Next slide. And so that's why we approached from the lateral side to avoid the oblique fissure. We use a standard coaxial needle technique, a semi-automatic gun. We noticed a pneumothorax happening during the biopsy, but because the patient was clinically stable, so we thought we'll proceed forward and not stop the procedure. Next slide. In terms of core needle biopsy, as a protocol, we take 5 to 6 tissue cores so that the sample is adequate for molecular testing and further immunohistochemistry testing also. So this was a small pneumothorax that developed during the procedure. However, the patient was stable clinically. Next slide. As a standard protocol, the patient was monitored in the daycare for 4 hours. BP pulse, SpO2 was monitored. And just before discharge, we took a chest x-ray that showed the pneumothorax was persistent and a small subcutaneous emphysema, which we see many a times. And we thought the patient is fine, and we discharge the patient. Next slide. After 2 days, the patient's son actually came to me first the next day that his father is having some swelling onto the face, which I actually disregarded. I thought this is not related to the biopsy, and maybe I just thought that it's continued with normal pain meds and that's it. But next day he followed up again, and his swelling has increased. So I asked him to bring the patient back to us. And when I saw him, the patient was actually puffed up. His cheeks were puffed up, the neck was swollen, and the chest was swollen. And on touching it, we could actually feel the crepitus. So I thought we were dealing with something else, and this is definitely some air within the subcutaneous tissue. So we took a CT chest That showed, next slide, please. So it showed an extensive subcutaneous emphysema, pneumomediastinum, and the air was actually tracking between the tissue planes up to the neck and onto the face, actually. So next slide. And the pneumothorax that was noted during the biopsy was still stable. So because the patient, only apart from the swelling part of it, a bit of discomfort, there were no other pressure symptoms, no respiratory distress, no vascular compromise. So these are three things that we need to look out whenever we do a patient and we land up with such a complication. So as a normal protocol, we just followed the patient up. I prescribed him some antibiotics and pain meds. And further in due course of time, the emphysematous changes subsided. And because the biopsy turned out to be squamous cell carcinoma, you started with further chemotherapy and further management. Next slide. In terms of reviewing of literature, we had seen a lot of times pneumothorax happening. And we know that the percutaneous CT guided lung biopsy is the established procedure and with a diagnostic accuracy of almost 98%. And post-procedure complications like pneumothorax and hemoptysis are relatively frequent. Pneumothorax can happen in almost 1/4 of the patients. However, patients requiring chest tube is only 5 to 6%. And we know that patient position, the small size, multiple punctures, and distance of the lesion to the pleura increases the pneumothorax. Next slide. However, the post-thoracic lung biopsy, the incidence of subcutaneous emphysema is very rare. And we just found two case reports describing it. There were a few case reports that talked about transbronchial, but none of it was transthoracic. The most common causes are post-surgery, trauma, infectious, and iatrogenic causes. And we probably felt the because of the pneumothorax, the tract didn't close, and air actually tracked along the subcutaneous plane and along the different tissue planes. So this was probably the cause of subcutaneous emphysema in our patient. And as it is, because he was a chronic smoker, he had bad lungs. So I thought that was the main reason that we landed up with this complication. Next slide. The management is individualized and depending upon the clinical context and severity of symptoms. The mainstay of management is conservative treatment only. However, we need to be careful for compromised airway and respiratory failure. If these are the signs that we are seeing. We should intervene at the earliest. And treatment options include generally giving a small incision and this is just like relieving the pressure. Next slide. So take home message is this complication highlights the importance of knowing about this rare but manageable complication. The appearance can be very alarming. Don't be afraid. Typically, these patients follow a benign course. And increased pressure can actually cause complications like upper airway compression or vascular compromise. So these are the only two subsets that you need to be careful for. And patients should be kept under close follow-up if such a complication happens. Next slide. These are my references. And thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Abhishek. Good learning point, actually, you know. But tell me, routinely we notice pneumothorax during percutaneous biopsy, we tend to aspirate it. So was aspiration attempted during procedure?
Sir, because it was, as you had seen the CT, it was trivial, well, not trivial, but it was still mild. I thought the patient was stable clinically, and this would probably get absorbed on its own. And because if you would have seen the biopsy site, sir, the pneumothorax had ascended because the patient was prone. I had ascended posteriorly and my needle was abutting the lesion. So I thought to aspirate, I would have to shift the position and probably make another puncture. So I thought because he was stable clinically, I should stop there only. But probably I should have aspirated.
I think it would have been a good idea to rescan the patient again after some time rather than, you know, just leaving him alone because he was stable. So in such a scenario, we actually don't leave it. We try to aspirate and it really works very well. And then still we don't leave the patient. We rescan after some time. And we never discharge such patients who develop pneumothorax, even if we have aspirated and they are stable. It's just a precaution. And you can actually do away with the percutaneous drainage in most of the cases. Secondly, we can use the positioning. You went from the lateral route. So we could have put that side down and tried, you know, that sealing of that. Then did you try any plugging of that percutaneous site?
I didn't do plugging, sir, because frankly, it was not pretty hemorrhagic. And because the patient was prone, the lesion had touched the chest wall. So there was, I didn't think that that would really help. But yes, we took a delayed scan of 5 minutes. Like once I finished the procedure as a normal protocol, we keep the patient on table, take a delayed scan after 5 minutes. And if the pneumothorax is increasing, then I personally go in and again and then do the aspiration. But you rightly said, sir, we need to be careful because many of these patients can come back in the evening and night, and even we might even lose the patient. So
especially you are saying, you know, patient at emphysema and yes, smoker, sir, and they are at a very high risk, yes, you know. So it would have been absolutely a good idea. But anyway, a good learning point. Arun, would you like to say anything?
I think in his case, the way he has done, so the where the little placement of needle, I think he would have not been able to aspirate unless until he would have made another puncture to aspirate. The patient was clinically stable. It was a fair idea to keep the patient observation for next 4 to 6 hours. And I think he has done the X-ray on the same day or next day?
Same day, sir, after 4 hours.
So at that time, looking at the pneumothorax, I think it was a fair decision to send the patient back at home. And it just happened that supported emphysema. And the most important thing we should understand that he has not panicked and it was managed conservatively.
That's a very important point. But I was just saying, you know, the precautions is always better, especially in a high risk case.
Yes.
Ajit, would you like to add anything?
Sir, according to the literature, to decrease the pneumothorax, there are one method is whenever we pull out the needle, there is just some jiggling is there. So there's some bleeding will be, that blood clot will plug the tract. So sometimes that will help. And the second one is that I learned from our thoracic surgeon, whenever there is subcutaneous emphysema, we should put the patient on oxygen, 100% oxygen, for at least 6 to 8 hours, because the oxygen is actually absorbing fast as compared to the normal air. So the subcutaneous emphysema resolve better if patient is on oxygen rather than on the room air, because room air is containing mostly nitrogen and oxygen and carbon dioxide. So the absorption of nitrogen is very slow as compared to the pure oxygen. So if we give the oxygen, 100% oxygen to the patient for 4 to 6 hours, subcutaneous emphysema is resolved as 50% faster as compared to the normal air.
Very good. I think this pushing that clot, you know, you just keep the stellate inside, don't go through and through, just leave it, let the clot form, and then while you're withdrawing, just push the clot in the track. So that really works very well sometimes.
And you come out, do just the needle on needle, so that will actually create hemorrhage.
Yeah. So anyway, very good learning point and nicely presented, Abhishek. Very nice.
Thank you, sir.
We can go on to the next case.
The next case will be presented by Dr. Indu Shekhar. Dr. Indu Shekhar, are you with us?
I couldn't see him. Any other presenter left?
We are left with Dr. Sunil Kanwat also, but he is also having trouble to join in. We have shared the links and everything with him. Should we wait for a minute? We will call him up and check.
Just give him a call and then tell us.
We will do that. We will call him up.
So before this session, we have an announcement that at 7:30, we have our virtual party for ISVIR midterm CME. So we can have cocktails and dinners, and that you have to make yourself at home.
And Ajit, can we send the bill to you?
We don't have so much sponsorship, but yeah, definitely we can try in the next conference. We can pay for the water you are adding into the whiskey. So rest you have to make, the cocktail you have to make. We can pay for the water, rest you have to make by yourself. And for the dinner, yeah, you can ask your wife or your colleagues and etc. And I think that will be the best idea to make the good food at home, and we can enjoy in our virtual party. Dr. CPS will sing a song for us. Dr. Rochitpa will sing a song for us.
Concert,
Dr. Arun just recovered from Corona will dance for us for a song. So Dr. Arun was like stuck in a room for a week. So now he is like singing and dancing. So we will have a good performance from his side. And we can have good song and dance from Dr. Vimal also, Dr. Abhishek. Dr. Abhishek will like Mogambo Kush, you are some tough dialogue. There must be some dialogue from Dr. Abhishek. And Dr. Yeah. Balaji, what are you doing in the virtual party?
I'm going to party really.
Dr. Balaji is actually partying behind the camera. He's just putting his static picture over here. No videos.
We will announce our best case in each session and the overall best case and the quiz result in the virtual party at 7:30. So I request all the participants and the jury to be there in virtual party at 7:30. And it will be start on 7:30. There is no delay in that part. We can delay the academic part, but we will never delay the party.
Ajit, I really want to congratulate the organizing team. Though we had corona, we had all these problems, like you people have taken the initiative and done it flawlessly. That's the awesome. That's a great thing that, you know, the organizing team, India Attitude, everybody has done flawless for the first time. I really appreciate you, everybody. I was really afraid that, you know, we might get a disconnected or somebody's talk might not come. Even in the conference, we face all these problems. But, you know, first time we are doing online and it has went flawlessly. Very nice. I really appreciate all of you and kudos to all of you people.
I think we were also quite apprehensive about all these problems. But I think the overall the participation of all the ISUL members was quite enthusiastic. All the jury members, all the participants. We have received quite a number of cases. We have to reject actually. We have to choose the best of the cases. That was the best part. And it was a good discussion all.
Yeah, Arun, I must say that it was an excellent academic feast, very nicely done, and I heartiest congratulations to all their entire organizing team and even India Attitude. I think they have done pretty well. We can have annual conference online if required next time, if the conditions don't permit. Today, I was actually chairing one of the sessions in ISNR. What they have done is they have recorded all the speakers' sessions, though they were present, but everything was pre-recorded and it was almost flawless. So the glitches which we are having today, somebody not able to share the screen, I think those we can prevent if we have the annual conference that way. This is one of my suggestions to you.
Well, actually, I'm not at all in favor of online conferences now. With this COVID has to go. We have to meet together. I really hate this virtual conferences.
Yes, yes.
Nobody's
yes.
interested.
No, I agree with you, but if conditions don't permit, hopefully if you are forced. Will gain in
The best part of the conference is meeting each other, sir.
Yes, yes.
Not a chance that we will come in PP, but we will go to Goa.
Yeah, yes, definitely.
Of course.
Dr. Hindu sir is there, I think.
Grab is coming down, we'll go to the Goa for conference.
We can go in PP kit.
Sir, I'm sorry to interrupt your Goa plans, but we have Dr. Hindu Shekhar with us now.
Welcome, Dr. Hindu Shekhar.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Well, this is a recent case which I really had a sudden shock while doing a tracheal stenting. This is a 52-year-old patient who had a carcinoma lung with mediastinal metastasis, liver, brain, everywhere. And diagnosed in 2018, he was actually treated with chemo, RT, everything, and he still had a progressive disease. In July, he got admitted with fatigue, poor general condition, and difficulty in breathing. And he was intubated and was on ventilatory support. But still, the oxygen saturation was not maintaining well. So they got a repeat CT. Now that CT shows large mass abutting the trachea, and as we come down, there was a narrowing. And did a reconstruction there, you can see that lower part is narrowed. And this narrowing was actually below the endotracheal tube. So with a lot of discussion how to manage this and all that with the primary team, we decided, okay, we can put a covered tracheal stent. And then through the endotracheal tube. So the plan was to place a small catheter through the tube and then instill local anesthetic initially to reduce the coughing. And then to introduce the covered stent over the stiff wire. And after confirming the position and partial deployment, the anesthetist is supposed to pull this endotracheal tube back a little so that we can complete the stent deployment. That was the plan, and everything was fine. We placed a small catheter, instilled the local anesthetic there, and then I tried to introduce the stent into the trachea. While introducing the stent, actually deployed, and then suddenly patient had desaturation. So in that situation, the anesthetist was trying to pull the endotracheal tube back a little so that the complete stent could be deployed. Next moment, I saw that the entire thing came out, endotracheal tube, the stent, everything came out into the mouth of the patient. Now immediately, fortunately, the anesthetist was experienced. They could put another endotracheal tube. Now I had the stent was completely outside in my hand. Now what to do? So the problem was to whether we can reintroduce the same stent after cleaning it, or whether we can use the additional stent. And that was a problem. Although the additional stent was available, but the sizes were not really congenial for that particular the patient. And I was also worried about the cost reduction and things like that. So I decided to try and reload the whole stent again into the system and reposition it again, and then remove the endotracheal tube. That was the plan. So I could actually do that, reposition the stent, and the endotracheal tube was withdrawn a bit, and then that's the stent you can see, and the endotracheal tube a little up over that. So I'm just going to show how we can actually reload the stent in a slightly bigger sheath so that we can, in case such a mishap happens, we can actually reposition the stent again through this one. This is just after all the things happened, I'm just demonstrating how a stent can be reintroduced into a little bigger sheath and then deployed. Actually, it has to be done over a guide wire and then take a bigger sheath. This is a very small stent just for demonstration. And we can actually position it inside with little effort and push it inside, and whatever the inner shaft or dilator is there, we can actually cut in the middle so that that can act as a pusher. So ultimately we could actually salvage this patient by repositioning and reintroducing the same stent with some difficulty. I just wanted to show this because it will be a panic situation when you actually lose a stent outside, or accidentally when it is completely deployed, it becomes a problem. So this way we can simply use a bigger sheet and then reintroduce the stent inside. And then to position it, we can usually use a dilator which is coming with the sheets, cut it so that it becomes a blunt one, so that the stent will not get stuck into the margin. So this is just a redeployed stent just for your Yeah, then the patient actually was shifted back to ICU. He did well for 2 days and oxygen saturation improved. He was doing well, but the disease was so bad, he succumbed to the disease due to other causes. Yeah, that's just a small presentation. Thank you.
Yeah, good evening, Dr. Indu.
Good evening, sir.
Very nice case. Did patient develop pneumothorax on the right? I mean,
no.
It appeared on the X-ray that some opacity had appeared when you were showing
the
case.
That was even that small pneumothorax was there even before.
Okay. So it didn't increase. It didn't increase because the lung, there was a round opacity near hilum appeared as a collapsed lung to me. That's why I asked this question.
No, problem was a huge mass in the
right side. Okay, right
upper. The trachea.
Okay.
So that was the issue. In fact, this is very unusual problem which we faced.
I agree.
Size of the stent.
Pardon?
Size of the stent.
Stent was 14 millimeters into 6 centimeters.
And you resheathed in which sheath?
Actually, the sheath which came for delivery was 14 French. Mm-hmm. So with the same sheath, I could reposition the stent again. So because it was a 14 French sheath, it was much easier. Otherwise, we had to search for another sheath and use it.
Okay, there are anybody?
I think I was the last candidate, last batsman.
We have Dr. Sunil Kalmat. He had some trouble joining in, but now I guess he's here.
Okay, Dr. Indu, thanks a lot for excellent case. Thank you.
Dr. Sunil, are you with us? I think we lost him again.
I think now we should finish this session. I thank all the participants, all the jury members for this, again, a wonderful session. So this is our last academic event, and next we are going to have our validatory function and party time also at 7:30. So I think regarding the joining the party, Kuhu, you have to announce anything?
Yes, sir. So the virtual party is at 7:30, and we will be announcing the prizes for all our cases today that we discussed today, as well as the quiz and fun times ahead. So we would request everyone to join in at 7:30, please.
So they have to join the same our app or
any? Sir, the Zoom link has been updated in the app, in the conference portal. So it's a simple link. Everybody has just to click on the link and they will join in. It is uploaded on the agenda page also. It is uploaded on the event feed page also. Plus, we have sent individual mails also just now.
Thank you.
So with the link, everyone can join.
Okay, thanks, Dr. Arun, and the entire organizing team for the opportunity. It was really wonderful to be part of it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Rather than conference, we should never miss this complication meet.
Yes.
Because doing procedure is one side and managing complication is the one most important thing. And thank you, Ajit, Arun, and all organizing team once again to make this possible. Thank you so much.
So one request to all the jury member to please share your scoring sheets with us.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, everyone. We are ending the session now. Thank you for joining in.